Hi, welcome to Wrokdown. I'm Wendy Stapleton. Our guest tonight is one of the unsung heroes of beat boom in Australia. Singer, guitarist, songwriter and author. In 1964, he became the fifth member of Billy Thorpe's backing band, the Aztecs, and he went on to become a star in his own right. Would you please welcome Mr. Tony Barber? Hey, Tony, how are you?
It's so nice to be here.
Lovely to meet you. We've actually never met before, but I know so much about you.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think I do. Only what I've read, but I'm sure you've got a lot of surprises in store for us tonight, I know that apart from your time with the Aztecs, everything else that you've done, you've got some very interesting stories.
Mm-hmm.
Tony, you were born in England, in the UK?
Yep, Norwich, Norfolk.
Norwich?
Yep.
And from a musical family?
No, no one in our family had ever played musical instruments or anything at all. No, total frumph. In fact, I was so different from the rest of the entire family tree. And my wife's heard me say this many times before. It's amazing, isn't it? How many things stick with you from your childhood and you just never forget. You can't get rid of that childhood memory. My family were invited to weddings, etc. And I kid you not, on the invitations it says, you know, da, 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 you can all come because my brother and my father and mother, you can come out, but don't bring Tony. He's too strange.
What because, was strange about you?
Because I read books and I was drawing and painting and I was interested in all sorts of other things. I didn't drink, I didn't smoke, I just wasn't interested. I was total creative. And my job was to go into town on the bus with a huge bag, white bag like Santa Claus, with all the dirty stuff and stick it in the laundromat there and sit there practically all day because there was a long cycles, mm-hmm. and put the money in and that was my job on Saturday to get pocket money. And while I was waiting between cycles, which could be an hour and a half, the place next door was a library. I wandered in this library and met this incredible woman who was a librarian, and she realised that I just discovered books, and she gave me books, and I was hooked.
Mm. So how did you go from this young book boy, mm-hmm. what's the word?
Bookworm?
to landing in Australia?
I started writing poems and I was doing all that paper sculpture stuff, which we'll speak about later. I always done that through my life. But I then started writing songs and picked up a guitar and I built my own guitar because I was left-handed. And so I built a left-handed guitar, made it just out of plywood and stuff, but it worked, it was okay. And then I did local folk singing and things and got a one spot on the local television show, Anglia Television, that was it, Anglia Television, in Norfolk, in England. And then when I was about, 19, 18, that's right, this girlfriend I had dropped me. And I was absolutely, totally heartbroken because I've always wanted to be married. Because I knew I needed someone to look after me. I wasn't, so I thought, oh. And by the way, at age 11, I thought, boys, girls are unbelievable. They're smarter, they're tougher.
I like you already.
They can do practically everything a guy can do. They are fantastic. And there are so many different varieties of girls and that. Guys, you put them in four little boxes, that's about it. That sums it all up.
I'm not going to make too many comments.
Anyway, this girl dropped me and I was heartbroken. I see this ad in the paper. And I open the paper and it says, come to Australia for £10. You know, the assisted migrant scheme. And I thought, I looked on the map. I thought, wow, that's a long way. £10, I can go all that way for that. I'm in this. And so to escape from the girl,
You did?
I came to Australia.
Where did you land, Sydney?
I landed in Perth, then Melbourne, and then Sydney. And then that's when I walked into Surf City on a Saturday afternoon. I walked into there and this guy came up to me. I auditioned on the Sunday. And that's where I met Billy. I went up and just sang a little folksy thing.
So what was Billy doing there that day? Was he
standing?
Because he was already established? Or?
Arrived there, and I think he just joined the Aztecs. And one of the guys didn't want to go full time. In fact, he's probably the best musician. He was a very serious musician. And Billy was down there, standing there. He came, "Hi, mate, got it." I come over and there's this little stocky, stocky, cocky kid. The strut, the whole thing.
He already had it.
He had it. Billy was born with it, you know. Billy was born a star, and he spent the rest of his life trying to convince everyone that he was. And he did a damn good job of it too. And he was eating this hamburger, and there's grease dropping on the floor, and I thought, I'll bet he's not going to pick that up. And he says, mate, he says, you sing, he says, you can't play the guitar for crap, he says, but you look good. You look like that, what's that band? I've heard of them, the Beatles. You look like that guy on the end in the Beatles, you know that group over there? I said, yeah, I've heard of them. But Australia hadn't at that stage.
Oh, really? Mm. So it was before?
And I said, oh, yeah. That Paul guy, Paul McCartney, because I'm left-handed. And he said, we're looking for one more member. He said, why don't you join our band? I said, okay, I'm in.
I know you have obviously so many stories.
Well, I can tell you one that no one's ever heard before, even they haven't heard it.
Is this an exclusive, Wrokdown
exclusive? Yes, I haven't told anyone this at all, publicly at all.
You can tell me, I won't
we
tell
We would
anyone.
Go on the tours, which was my way of being introduced to Australia. I mean, what a way to discover Australia by joining this group of four insane madmen, and being taken around Australia. So I became the token pommy, and they tried every, you know, I mean, I was fair game, absolutely fair game. I mean, you could touch me and the green paint would come off on you. And I'm trying to remember now the point I was trying to make to you. Oh, yes, that no one had ever heard. We get to some of these country towns, we do the big dance, wonderful, etc. Get back to the hotel. And to me, because I was really tunnel creative, you know, that was good, you know, I've got to work on another song. We get to about 11:30 and all hell's breaking loose in the hotel, the noise. So regular as clockwork, I would pick up the phone. Is that the local police station? I'm in such and such motel. I said, and there is some pop group here making an incredible lot of noise, and I can't go to sleep. I said, I think you should do something about that, chum. And I used to do that all the time, and they never
they
found
didn't know
out.
It was you.
No. Now they're too old to do anything about it.
Some of them definitely can't do anything about it. My God, you naughty boy.
I know.
Okay, we're going to take a short break.
Yeah.
We'll be back soon.
Wrokdown.
Welcome back to Wrokdown. My special guest is Tony Barber. Tony, you've just joined the Aztecs. You're a young fellow.
Yep. Never seen Australia.
Never seen Australia.
Scared of everything that moves. I didn't know it at the time, but I went to live in King's Cross. I thought, that'll be safe there. They're making those series, aren't they now? Was it Underbelly?
Underbelly, thing?
Yeah. Right, oh. And Billy said to me, he says, mate, he says, I said, this is rather, it took me a while to figure it out. One night it was brought home to me. We're up on the stage and we're playing and we just finished one break. And I looked, I said, Billy, I said, that guy, he just hit that guy there. I said, and the other guy's hitting now. I said, we'll have to go and stop. He said, mate, don't get off the stage. I said, but they're fighting. And those girls, they haven't got any shoes on. They've got bare feet. And I don't see any ties on the guys. No one's wearing ties. I said, this is a really strange place, Billy. This is a really weird place,
you
Australia.
You must have been such a rarity in Sydney.
Yes, I was. So he stopped me. Don't get off the stage. You won't come back alive.
So when did this all come to an end?
About 12 months later. We had about four or five number one records, hit of the year, group of the year, etc., etc. And this sounds really weird. It sort of got boring. It got predictable. Especially, you know, 3 weeks ago, some guy comes up and punches me and puts me in hospital. This is a Surf City. It was a really tough place.
How did you find yourself on television?
Because
that's where I remember seeing you.
I forgot one small detail. I ran out of money. And so I started doing record producing for people. I produced some records with Ray Brown.
Yes?
Yep, a couple
Ray Brown
of his.
And the Whispers?
Yep, because I got work with Festival Records. And then, is it Frank Packer? Not Frank Packer, his father.
Frank Packer, Kerry's father.
That's right, yes, Frank Packer. Starting a record company up called Everybody's, because he had an Everybody's magazine. And I was the first artist they were signed up to with Nat Kipner.
Yeah.
As their R&R man. And And I'd written a song which I tried to give away to everyone. I tried to give it to Billy. I tried to give it to Ray Brown. No one wanted to touch it. So I thought, all right, I'll do it myself.
And which was?
Which was Someday.
That's my song.
But even then I didn't get a hit because the radio stations wouldn't play it. Because they said, no, it's on this label called Everybody's. We're not going to promote
a magazine. But I thought
it
was a big hit.
Well, yeah, but still they wouldn't play it. So Kerry Packer said, okay, we'll change the record label and we'll change the company name. They changed it to Spin. And they re-released it. Is that what they call a sleeper? A sleeper.
Certainly.
And they put it out twice.
And it was a huge hit.
Then it was a hit. And within 4 months, I was doing this national tour. I'd signed on to do it. I walked into the hall and I knew who was the headliner. And I said to, there were several artists, I forget who they were. And I was second on the bill and top of the bill was Billy. I walked up and I says, bet you thought you'd never see me again, Billy.
What did he say?
He said, yeah. He said, but who's top of the bill, baby? I said, fair enough.
Did you get on?
Yeah, we got on.
Yeah.
We got on. We had this really unusual relationship. We knew each other too well, both of us, too well. So we needed space between ourselves all the time. And
you were also telling me before you were the only person that wouldn't back down to him.
No, I wouldn't. No.
So there's some sort of respect going on there.
I think there was. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I respected him enormously.
After your career here in Australia,
mm-hmm.
I know Billy went to America.
Yep.
You went to America.
Yep, he went quite a while before me.
Before you.
Yep. Billy met us at the airport in this great big wagon and took our baggage and things and we rented a place in Westwood, I think it was Westwood, yep. And I had some toy designing stuff I was doing and I was having a bit of a problem with one of the toy companies in America. They weren't doing it as they were supposed to do it under license. And that's when I realised how brilliant and how terrifying a negotiator Billy was. I mean, he absolutely put the fear of God into some of those toy people.
Even over there.
They could not cope with Billy. They just, it was absolutely amazing.
You came back to Australia eventually.
Yep.
And I know that you've written how many books?
About 30. About 30 children's books. And one what I would call an adult book, which was Long Way Till You Drop, which was about the tour.
We'll take a short break and we'll come back with a little bit about that tour because you all reunited.
The tour I didn't want to do.
But you did.
I know.
We'll be back soon.
Wrokdown.
Welcome back to Wrokdown. I'm with the amazing Tony
Barber. I
thought you
were going to say Anthony Barber then. I'm only Anthony when I'm in trouble. I quake with
actually,
that.
Actually, Molly Meldrum once said to me, I called him Ian. He said, makes me scared when people call me Ian.
Yeah.
No, the reason I say amazing is because we've got so much to show everybody, all of the wonderful inventions and things that you do today. But just before we go on to that, can you please tell us a little bit about coming back to Australia and, of course, then Billy Thorpe talking you, or was it your wife, talking you into doing It's a Long Way to the Top, the big tour?
Well, Billy and I often wouldn't communicate for 5-6 months, sometimes at a time, and then we just pick up where we left off. And this phone call came through from Billy one day, and I said, hi, Billy, what do you want? And he said, guess what, mate, I'm getting the band back together again. And I remember saying to him, not with me, you're not, because I went through hell before. I didn't want any bags. No, this is totally different. You get your own room, 4-star room. You're in your own room. I said, oh, good. He says, and you don't have to lift or do anything at all. A guy is going to put the guitar on you just before you step on stage. They'll take it off when you come off stage. I said, Rolls Royce. He says, you'll love it. And I said, no, I'm not really interested in that. And my wife then, she said, who was that? I said, Billy. He says, he's getting the band back together. It's going to be bigger than Ben-Hur. Everything's bigger than Ben-Hur with Billy. Yeah. And she said, you have to do it. Because she knew that Colin, Vince and Bluey were all hanging out to join up again and do the reunion. And we were one of the last major bands of that era to reform again. But we all were flown to Perth to start rehearsals, and I'm sitting in the foyer of the hotel, very begrudgingly.
You didn't call the police again,
total,
did you?
total fish out of water. I had the number. I'm sitting in the foyer and thought, oh, this is going to be, oh God, this is going to go on for 3 weeks. This is, you know, why did I say I'd do this? And I was watching, it was quite touching to see. You'd see artists come in through the door, well-known names, and then they'd stop and they'd see someone standing over at the foyer and they go, and they'd recognise, because no one had seen each other 45 years, you know, teeth had gone, hair had gone, everything had gone, you know, and waste had come, the only thing hadn't come out, and that, and there'd be these silent rituals, and they'd say, wow, mate, great to see you again, and you see these top stars, you know.
Was it wonderful?
It was quite, I found that quite touching, and that's when I started to get a feel of what was going on. And after about the second day and into rehearsals and that, I started to realise, I thought, something quite special is happening. When does a group of people have the privilege of going back 40 or 50 years and reliving, in effect, their childhood, we're all kids, childhood, but doing it Rolls Royce this time? Very rare, very rare. And on the first night we opened up, and then I saw the audience there, and the reaction that we were getting, and I thought something quite special is happening here. So I started keeping a diary, and because I didn't get involved in all the part, they just picked up the parties like it was yesterday.
Absolutely, as you do.
Yes. So this time I didn't follow the police. I just started writing.
Too busy writing.
Yeah.
Is the book out?
Mm.
I thought it was. It's called
Long Way Till You Drop. Yes,
because
of course it was all old guys.
By Tony Barber. Now, 30 books, as you said, you've done, but let's talk about your latest project, because as you said, you were always into drawing, reading, everything very artistic. This is amazing. So
creating.
So
my long-time hobby,
your hobby, yeah,
is paper sculpture. I did that when I was 11 years of age, because I knew I could earn money, pocket money, by doing paper sculpture things and selling the stuff. And so I've kept it up off and on and off and on. And then about a year ago, I walked into this big shop and realized that the rest of the world had caught up. And you've got, you know, these scrapbookers and scrapbooks, card makers and stampers, and couldn't believe it. And there's millions of them everywhere.
And people are making a living out of it.
Yeah, I'm stunned. And I thought, well, I can do that. I've been doing that for years. So I've now been designing all new forms of paper sculptures and crafting things that people can do. And I'm going to intertwine those with books, craft books and things, and that's what I'm doing now.
So you're away?
Away.
And you have a deal?
I've got deals and things. Yeah, several.
Can you show us your
work? Here's one that I created that you'll be able to make yourself. Doesn't look like it, but you can.
So do you buy it as a little kit?
No, you would get the cutting dies.
You
can get home little cutting machines now.
Oh, I see. So you
get a die, you put your cardboard or paper underneath it, whatever colour you want, and you put the die through and wheel the handle, boom. And this is only three pieces of cardboard. It looks more, but it's only three. And they just click together, and you can make that.
That's beautiful. So you make them yourself.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And these?
I've created a little thing that makes roses. Anyone can make them. Called a rose twirler. You'll see that soon for a company that asked me. And that makes roses like this. So I brought you one this evening too.
Oh, thank you, Tony. That is beautiful.
I give it to you in my teeth, but they might fall out.
Well, I'll put it right here. I won't make too much of a noise. Look at that. It's absolutely beautiful work. Well, look, good luck with Tony's...
Paper crafts.
Mm. And I know there'll be many more books to come.
There will be, yeah. Don't know what they'll be about, but there will be.
I'm definitely going to go and get a copy of...
Long Way Till You Drop.
It's been wonderful talking to you. You're a very, very funny man. And thank you for our inside scoop. Thanks, Tony.
Pleasure.
Thank you. Good night.
You know who you are. You know just how far you've come and the roads you've traveled. You know where you've been and you know what you've seen through these times of trouble. Yeah, you are always there. Your foot's are everywhere. Ordinary man, doing all you can each day just to make ends meet, yeah. Everybody cries, we are all the same that way, trying to keep the flame alive. We're all the same. Stand, there's no master plan, you just keep on going. You know who you are deep inside your heart, there's no disguise or mask there. You are no plastic hero, no celluloid hero. Ordinary man, doing all you can each day just to make ends meet, yeah. Everybody cries, we are all the same that way, trying to keep the flame alive. We're all the same that way. We're all the same.